So, لغةً, فقه means understanding. ما نفقه كثير مما تقول.
العلم أشراف مطلب وطالبه لله أكرام من يمشي على قدم. العلم نور مبين يستضيء به أهل السعادات والجهال في الظلم.
طيب. Obviously, as you know, there are many sciences in the science of Islam. Fiqh, Aqidah, Tafsir, and so on. What we're studying now is Al-Fiqh. Now, Lughatan, in the Arabic language, it has a meaning. And in the Sharia, it has a meaning. Lughatan, you tend to find that when the scholars are talking about, when they're defining, or giving a meaning for a terminology, they mention what it means, Lughatan, in the Arabic language and also in the terminology of the fuqaha or the terminology of the scholars. So lughatan, fiqh means understanding. ما نفقه كثير مما تقول. As Ya Shu'aib, when they said to Shu'aib, we don't understand a lot of what you're talking about. When Musa was making dua, وحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. يعني يفهموا, so that they understand, because he had a bit of a lisp when he was talking, Musa عليه السلام. So that's the dua that he made, يفقه قولي. So that's what it means, الفهم. Like when we're talking about the Sharia, it has a different meaning, which is connected to الفهم. You tend to find that the meaning it has in the Arabic language is more general and more broad than the meaning it has when it comes to the scholars of the fiqh, or scholars of hadith, or scholars of usul al-fiqh, and in the terminology base, from a terminology angle, it is more specific than a language-based angle. طيب. So that's the meaning of al-fiqh lughatan. When we're talking about istilahan, this is the way you write istilah. Istilahan. It means العلم, knowing الأحكام الشرعية, the أحكام, the rulings of the Sharia, the rulings of the Sharia. When we say the rulings of the Sharia, talking about things like Fatiha is wajib to read in Salah, صح? The Fatiha is wajib to read in the Salah. What's the دليل for it? لا على كل, that's a حكم, that is the حكم. What's the دليل for it? لا صلاة لمن لم يقرأ به فاتحة الكتاب. There's no صلاة for the one that doesn't read the فاتحة. طيب. So that's the حكم, that ruling. How did we derive it, or how did we come to know of it? Through the شريعة, through the حديث of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. So that is the meaning of الأحكام الشرعية. طيب. العملية. العملية meaning the actual actions that we do. The salah is an action that we do. Zakah is an action that we do. Fasting is an action that we do. Hajj, nikah, talaq. These are things that the Muslim does. These are the amaliyah, that is the meant by the acts that a person does in terms of the Sharia, from a fiqh point of view. What's the opposite to that? Belief. Aqidah is the opposite to that. The opposite to, طبعاً write this down, لكن the opposite to amaliyah, things that we do physically, is what? Things that we believe. أو اعتقاد, أو creed. طيب. So when we're talking about al-fiqh, we're not talking about the ahkam of tawheed. Anything to do with Tawheed, what the person is going to be asked in the grave, the i'tiqad of Ahlul Sunnah with the Quran, seeing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Jannah, Jahannam. That's not what is mentioned, or that is not what is talked about in this bab, in the bab of Al-Fiqh. مَعَ أَدِلَّتِهَا أَتَفْصِيلِيَّةِ مَعَ أَدِلَّتِهَا, along with its evidences, along with its evidences, the specific evidence. أدلتها التفصيلية بمعنى you're talking to someone and you're discussing whether salah is wajib or not. And they say to you, salah is wajib. You say, what's your dalil? What's your evidence? And they say, وَأَقِيمُ الصَّلَاةِ. And you're again talking about debating whether zakah is wajib or not. And then you say, they ask you what's the dalil, and you say, وَآتُ zakah. That is the meaning of أدلتها التفصيلية. It's specific evidence relating to that hukum. So the reason why I mentioned ta'rif is we have to define what we're studying. We're not studying aqidah, we're not studying tafsir, we're not studying hadith. Like, we have to understand and define what it is that we're studying. So we're studying the ahkam that relate to the physical acts that the Muslim does in his day-to-day worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Tayyib. So that's the ta'rif of it. What you probably, and the next issue that we want to study, which is an introduction, is something which a lot of you are aware of. By the way, I've noticed, mashallah, the brothers, there's quite a lot today. Tayyib. Mashallah alaykum. At a madhab, the issue of having a madhab. That's usually a topic that is talked about, and a lot of people somewhat have ta'asub, and there's a lot of debate that goes on regarding having a madhab or taking a madhab. What do you think is the ruling on taking a madhab according to what you've studied? Jayd, Allahu A'lam, nisul jawab, half of the answer. طيب. Huh? لا, I'm talking about what is the ruling on it, not the madhab that you ascribe to. When I say madhab, I'm talking about the madhab, for example, even Ahl al-Hadith, their madhab. Like madhab al-Shafi'i, Hanabila, Hanafiya, Malikiya, Zahiriya. Muhammad.
If the person doesn't
have knowledge
and he's a muqallid,
like he's a blind fellow, then upon him
he has to ask for wajib.
He has to?
It would be wajib for him, if he's a person that's not able to go into the evidence himself.
Wajib for him to take a madhab.
So it depends on the person,
basically,
and their condition.
Taib, fair enough. Taib, for the person that's able to differentiate, and is it haram for him or halal for him? Halal for him.
If he's able to read the evidence himself, then it's wajib for him to do that.
So it's, if it's wajib upon him to look into the adilla, then it's haram for him to take a madhab. طيب. In general, there are three different opinions regarding taking a madhab. The first madhab, or the first opinion, is that it is wajib to take a madhab. That, when I'm talking about madhahib, I'm talking about anything relating to fiqh. I'm not talking about the madhab of, يعني, for example, مسألة خلق القرآن. يعني, the madhab of Ahlul Sunnah is that the Quran is not created, and it's the kalam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, صح? That's the madhab of Ahlul Sunnah. The madhab of the Asha'ira is that it is kalam nafsi. The madhab of the Mu'tazila is that it is created, صح? That's not the type of madhab I'm talking about. فقه, مسائل الفقه. لا, four madhahib, there's the other extra madhab of al-zahiriya, that take the apparent ruling of any text, whether it's a Quran, an ayah, or a hadith. Or madhab al-hadith. Madhab al-hadith. But in terms of fiqh, طيب, the first opinion is that it is wajib to take a madhab. So it's wajib upon every single person to say either I'm a Hanafi or Shafi'i or Maliki or a Hanafi. Reason being, because a person cannot derive the rulings on their own. They're not able to look in the Quran and the Sunnah and pick out the rulings. That's the first opinion. The second opinion is that it is haram. It's haram, not permissible to take a madhab. And anyone that takes a madhab has opposed the sunnah. Reason being, because it's wajib to take the dalil and understand the dalil and implement the dalil. If that's halal and haram, what's the third opinion, do you reckon? Huh? Mutawassit, in between. And the third opinion is that it is permissible to take a madhab. It is permissible to take a madhab or ascribe yourself to a specific madhab. Or ascribe yourself to a specific madhab, but it is not wajib. But it is not wajib.
Mubah.
Mubah. But also, yani permissible is mubah. But also, at the same time, it's not permissible to have ta'assub, to be staunch, and to blind follow a specific madhab. Huh? Who actually says haram? Different scholars from different madhahib. Some of them to the extent that, especially the Hanafiya and the Shafi'iyya, there's always been a long going feud between the two. To the extent that they say, they write in their books of fiqh, is it permissible for a Shafi'i to pray behind a Hanafi? To the extent that the Hanafiya say, is it permissible, they ask themselves, is it permissible for a Hanafi man to marry a Shafi'i woman? And then some of them replied with, say, na'am, it's permissible, just like it's permissible to marry the woman from Ahlul Kitab. Shuf al-Qiyas. Huh? So they're the ones that say it's wajib, or you have to take a madhab. And you'll find that in general amongst a lot of people that you ask. Right. Which one is the strongest opinion according to you guys? Huh? The third one, what? Because I sugarcoated it. Half-half. Between.
Between, eh?
Mm.
I don't know where I wrote it. I wrote my one, it's wajib to take a madhab.
And that's the second, the first opinion.
Okay, the third one is in between, eh?
In between. It's permissible, but it's not wajib, and it's not, blind following is not permissible. Tayyib. He says he can't. Naam. A lot of scholars say that. A lot of scholars say that. Sahih. Ittiba. It's going to be ittiba. That's the third opinion. Yani, that you're going to be following this specific madhab not because of the individual himself, lakin because of the text being closest to their opinion. A man came to Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahmatullahi alayhi, and he said to him, he was a Hanafi man, he was a Qadi, he was a judge, and he said to me, Shaykh, a lot of people I find it quite confusing when I'm dealing with my madhab and I'm giving a judgment, because a lot of people tell me to leave my madhab and sometimes it can oppose the Sunnah. So he said, I went to Shafi'iyah, and the Shafi'iyah said, just stay on your madhab, and everything's done and dusted, so just stay with your madhab, and you're not going to do much by leaving the madhab, so just stay on your madhab. He also went to Sufiyah, and the Sufiyah said, Stakhi, seek the guidance of Allah, but they didn't give him an answer. So he came to Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah. Shaykh al-Islam, from his fiqh and his understanding, he said to me, Shuf, he said to him, Shuf, the madhab is one of three. When a ruling comes to you, or a situation, or a case comes to you, and you look into the madhab, and there's a ruling in the madhab, it's one of three. Either the madhab is the stronger opinion, and the dalil is on their side. The dalil is on their side. So when you look at all of the other madhabs, your madhab is closest to the sunnah because of the dalil that it carries in any specific issue. Shaykh al-Islam said to him, with regards to that one, then follow your madhab. Because in reality you're following the haqq, the sunnah. The second issue, or the second rule that it could possibly take, is that it is marjuh, it is the weaker opinion. That it is the weaker opinion. And the other madhahib may be stronger or closer to the evidence than your madhab. As for this second type, then leave it and go with the evidence. As for the third type of issue, the third one that can come around, it is masail that are ijtihadiyya. They're based on the ijtihad and the knowledge of the person and the way he derives the rulings. And the masail ijtihadiyya, they're those issues that you can't say for 100%, you can't say 100% that is the haqq. That is the haqq. Like in the masail dhanniyya that is rajih, according to any one alim. So the Shaykh said to him, with regards to this third type, then ijtahid and follow what you believe to be closest to the haqq. But that is in the masail that are ijtihadi. Taban, someone can't turn around and say, I've made ijtihad that salah is not wajib. Reason being, because it's qat'i, it's not, there's no room for ijtihad. So that's the ruling, or that's the general ruling of making or having or following a madhab. You can go further in detail if you want by going to Al-Madkhal ila ilmi al-fiqh li Shaykh Sulaiman al-Ruhayli. Tayyib. The third issue is the tariqh of fiqh. This fiqh that we're talking about, istilahan, how did it come about? How did it come about? In general, any ilm or any science from the science of Islam, you will find that every single science started at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or the origin of it was around at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. However, it may not have had the same name, lakin it was around at the time of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the time of the companions. So fiqh, what did we explain fiqh to be? The actions that we carry out when we're worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on a day-to-day basis, huh? Was this around at the time of the Messenger or not? Tab'an, it was around. So any time an issue came up, whether it was jihad, sadaqah, zakah, the amount to pay for zakah, the salah, what to do in salah, what to do if you forget, so on. What used to happen is that when the companions had a question, they would come to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam would give them a fatwa. If the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not have an answer at that particular time, he would wait for the revelation to come down. So that was how rulings were derived and known during the time of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. After the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and obviously the Prophet was a qadi, he was a judge, So anytime two people come to him with a quarrel or any sort of debate argument, then he would be the one that judges between them. After the death of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the companions ridwanullahi alayhim, they carried out the task of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Khulafa al-Rashidun, and the other companions ridwanullahi alayhim. So they went to Dimishq, they went to Iraq, they went to stayed in Hijaz and so on. And people used to come to them for fatawa. And then they would give the fatawa or give the fatwa according to what they'd learnt from the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the companions, the reason why their understanding takes precedence over anyone's understanding, any scholar's understanding, is because the companions witnessed the revelation being revealed to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They knew why the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said this specific hadith. They understood the objectives of the Sharia. They understood why the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, what provoked him, what caused him to say what he said, and in what situation did he say it sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I'll give you an example to prove that the understanding of the companions takes precedence and is more important and more valuable than the understanding of anyone else, whoever they may be. Now we're in this room at this particular moment, sah? It's a Saturday afternoon. If there is a leakage in the corner, or there's water leaking down right over here, this on top of us, this area now, and the water is gushing forth, and there's a lot of water. طيب. What some of us may do is we may take our thobes off, coats off and everything, and put it on the floor so that the floor doesn't get wet. Or we may put black bags, or we may put buckets and so on, right here. طيب. So every single one of us will understand why half an hour later, or an hour later, when everything's dried up, every single one of us will understand why these coats and these hijabs and these baskets are here, sah? Or these buckets are here. طيب. How about if someone comes 3 hours later, or comes on a Monday morning, and they see a bunch of hijabs or thobes or imamas, coats lying around all on the floor? Will they understand what the reason is, or the reason behind these items of clothing being here? Will they understand? Even if we tell them, will they have a full picture? Yeah, obviously they won't have a full picture. Like every single one of you now has a clear picture, a clear image of exactly what happened and why it happened, and how you prevented it, or how you tackled it. And that's the difference between the companions ridwanullahi alayhim and anyone else that comes after them. They witnessed the reason why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said what he said and why he said it, and in the situation, the surroundings at his time. So that's the reason why the understanding of the companions takes precedence over anything else. Then when the companions passed away, the burden came to the tabi'in, the followers of the companions, and then so on, the followers of the tabi'in, and so on, and then the scholars that came after them, right up until our time. طيب. During that time, after the companions had passed away, and during the time of the tabi'in, and the later stages of the companion season, or the companions generation, there appeared two main madrasas, two main school of thoughts, two main madhahib. Madrasat Ahlul Madina, Madrasat Ahlul Hadith, the madrasa of Ahlul Hadith, which was prominent in Mecca, Medina, Hijaz in general, and Madrasat Ahlul Ra'yi, the madrasa of the people of logic and intellect, and that was predominant in Iraq. So as you can tell by the name or by the title of it, Madrasat Ahl al-Hadith was closer to the Hadith. The reason is because in Hijaz, in Mecca and in Medina, the fitna was qalil, it was small, there wasn't much fitna, it was minimal. Also, the hadiths of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam were preserved by the scholars that remained in that vicinity and the companions that remained there as well. طيب. However, when we look across the board in Iraq, there was a lot of fitan. Iraq has always been a place of fitan. That's why Hajjaj ibn Yusuf was sent there by Abd al-Malik ibn Marwan. طيب. There was a lot of fitan, killings and so on. Khawarij came out from there. The Qadariya, they came out from there. طيب. There was also a lot of fitan in terms of the hadith. People making up a hadith, al-wad'i, or hadith al-mawdu'a, fabricated a hadith, was very common. To the extent that if someone wanted to sell an item, for example, if someone wanted to sell pineapples, they would make up a hadith and say the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, anyone who buys or eats pineapples will have the barakah of Jannah. كذا على طول. Just for the sake of making sure that someone buys their commodity or buys their whatever it is that they were selling. So there was that fitna as well. That caused the scholars to not accept every single hadith they heard. That's what prevented them from hearing a lot of a hadith and accepting a lot of a hadith. So they had to use their logic. Or they had to use their ijtihad, their intellect, when a situation would come to them. Someone would come to them and ask them for a fatwa. Because they did not have much ahadith at that time, at the time of Imam Abu Hanifa and so on, a lot of their rulings were based upon, or some of their rulings were based upon intellect. Whereas with Ahlul Medina, because they had the hadith, any mas'ala comes, any issue comes, and they've got a hadith for it. And if there isn't a hadith for it, they would make ijtihad. So they were the two main schools of thoughts at the time of the tabi'een, and the time towards the end of the companions. طيب. There was kind of like a rift between them. And then Imam al-Shafi'i rahmatullah alayhi, Muhammad ibn Idris, al-Shafi'i rahmatullah Abu Abdullah, he came and he became like the one that molded and brought these two madaris together. That's why in Ilm Usul al-Fiqh, when they're talking about how Usul al-Fiqh came about, Imam al-Shafi'i was the first one to put pen to paper in the Ilm of Usul الفقه. طيب. That's to do with the two madrasas. As for الفقه, you'll often see that there's a difference of opinions. There's three opinions on this, or there's two opinions, and the stronger opinion or the weaker opinion, and the evidence for this and that. You'll find that a lot in الفقه. Now it's very important to understand and to comprehend this khilaf. At the very least, to know that there's a khilaf in this mas'ala. The reason being, the reason why it's important to know is that so later on you don't oppose the ijma'. For example, if you know that there's no khilaf in this mas'ala and there's ijma', and we'll see what ijma' is. Ijma' means a consensus amongst all of the scholars. If you know that a specific mas'ala, there's ijma' in it, you won't come up with a new opinion. Like you will say that, madama there's an ijma', then that ijma' is a hujjah, or is proof in and of itself. Whereas if you know that there's khilaf in the mas'ala, you won't be so strong in trying to refute the person that takes the other opinion. And the masail of the akathir, we've studied a few of them in the masail to do with shurutu salah, things that nullify the wudu, for example. The Shaykh mentioned about 8 things. We mentioned there's about 4 things or 5 things. Like, if you have these issues and you know that there's khilaf in them, later on, you won't be so strong trying to refute someone and trying to prove your point. Also, you'll understand where this person is coming from and the evidence that they're using and what they're using as evidence. That's why I said to you, unless a person is like Sheikh Saleh Al-Fawzan or someone's fully comprehended and understood the Sharia, it's not befitting that they become haughty and mutakabbir in the masail of al-fiqh that are khilafiyah, the things to do with the masail or the issues that there may be khilaf in. So even if you see a Hanafi putting their hands underneath their belly button, do not be strong against them in refuting them and saying it's a bid'ah, it's this and this and this. طيب. The Hanabil, a lot of them in the Zad Mustaqni, they say underneath, it's okay. Sheikh Saleh Al-Fawzan, while I was in the lesson, Sheikh Fawzan, he was asked and he said, تحت أو فوق, wherever. So in general, not to be harsh when you're dealing with these sort of masail that are to do with al-fiqh, and the khilaf in it is somewhat strong, and there's evidence on this side and there's evidence on this side. That's to do with fiqh, not aqeedah, not issues to do with aqeedah. With issues to do with aqeedah, you can't say, khali walli, wallah, there's khilaf between the Shaykh and the Mu'tazila and the Ahlul Sunnah, so kullun ala shakilati. La. That you have to be firm upon the haq. يعني madhab ahl al-haq, madhab ahl al-hadith is always the haq. Madhab ahl al-hadith is always the haq with regards to these major issues to do with aqeedah. I'll give you an example. There was a time Ibn Muhammad, Sheikh Muhammad bin Salih al-Uthaymeen rahimahullah, while he was in Hajj, some Hujjaj pilgrims from Indonesia came to him. Before they came to him, they came to an individual who was not on the level of Sheikh Muhammad bin Salih al-Uthaymeen rahimahullah. So the Indonesians, they're Shafi'is. And Shafi'is in Hajj, they believe, from their madhab, that you can slaughter the Hadi before the 10th day, Yawm al-Nahar, before the Eid day. Tayyib. So these Indonesians, Hujjaj, when they were in Medina, before the Hajj had even started, they all done their Hadi. They all slaughtered in Medina. Then they came to Mecca, Mina. And they were asking, in Mina, what happens is that the lead up to Hajj, there's always different jealousies with the scholars, different mashayikh from different countries, everyone in his tent getting asked questions because the Hujjaj, a lot of them are ignorant on the rulings of Hajj. So they asked the specific individual, they said to him, these Hujjaj, they're from Indonesia, they slaughtered before they came to, before Yawm al-Nahar, before they came to Mecca, in Medina, what should they do? He said, la la, that's haram, not permissible, and the Prophet ﷺ said this and this. So every single one of them has to slaughter again. The Hujjaj was shocked. A lot of them crying and thinking that the ibadah won't be accepted or wasn't accepted. Tayyib. Reason being, because a lot of them are from poor backgrounds. They barely made it to Hajj. They barely made or had the money to perform one slaughtering, let alone telling them all to perform another type of slaughtering on Yawm al-Nahar. Then a few people went to Shaykh Muhammad bin Salih al-Uthaymeen rahimahullah ta'ala, and the Shaykh got angry. And he said, if it was up to me, I would not allow or I wouldn't allow someone who is not well grounded in the four madhabs to give a fatwa in Hajj. And he said, as for those hujjaj that performed the hadyi or the slaughter in the Nahr in Medina, then it's okay for them. Reason being, because they followed an imam and they followed the madhab and they asked what was wajib upon them. فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ ذِكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. And they did that. So after slaughtering, the sheikh said, it suffices. The hadi that they stun in Medina. So it shows that the sheikh, rahimahullah, he didn't say it's only a madhab al-Shafi'i, خَلِّ وَلِّ. He gave it importance. And he had mercy upon these poor individuals, these masakeen who were worried what they're going to do about their hajj. طيب. We're going to start the kitab inshaAllah. That was just the muqaddimah, so that you can understand that on a lot of these issues we're going to see there's a lot of khilaf. طيب. Now these notes, I believe I've sent them out via email. Prophet Abdul Rahman has probably put it in the groups. These notes are just kind of like something to help you on the side, to help you understand the masail in general. So the evidence in here is, yeah, there is a types of evidence. Lakin, the main thing that we're going to be studying is the book, Kitab Manhaj al-Salikin. And there is a translated version. It's a very good translation. I believe you can order it on the net. I've sent the link to brother, Sheikh Abu Aisha. So anyone that can print them out and keep them with them, inshallah, hopefully, they'll find it somewhat beneficial when revising on a day-to-day basis. طيب, with regards to the book, we're going to start. Hopefully, we've got enough time to complete the muqaddimah. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, wa bihi nasta'inu, alhamdulillah, nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruhu wa natubu ilayh. ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا من يهديه الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. I'm going to read it in Arabic and translate it to English inshallah. لكن it's important that you guys have the book, even if it's an Arabic copy, even if it is an Arabic copy. طيب, because the student is going to get lost if the teacher is just waffling on and the students can't see exactly what it is that they're reading or that he's reading. طيب, the Sheikh starts off with saying, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, in the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, beneficent, the most merciful. Wa bihi nasta'inu, asking that, says that it's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who we seek assistance and aid from. Alhamdulillah, all praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the meaning of praise, or alhamd, is mentioning the perfections of the one that you're praising while glorifying him and honoring him. That's the meaning of Alhamd. نحمده ونستعينه, we seek his aid. ونستغفره, we seek Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us. ونطوب إليه, and we return back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا, and we seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the evil of our souls, وسيئات أعمالنا, and the evil deeds that we do. من يهديه الله فلا مضل له, the one that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides, there's none that can misguide. ومن يضلل فلا هادي له, and the one that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala misguides, there's none that can guide. Before we move on from that point, the Sheikh says, طبعاً وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. Sheikh will witness that Allah, there's none that has the right to be worshipped except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his final messenger, his servant and his final messenger. طيب, with regards to the guidance where the Sheikh says, من يهديه الله فلا مضل له, the scholars mentioned that there's two types of guidance, two types of hidayah. Two types of hidayah. The first type is the hidayah of enlightenment and teaching. Enlightenment and teaching. And the meaning of that is that a person guides someone to the haqq. Meaning he gives them the ruling of a specific issue, or he gives them advice, or he tells them to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah said this and this, therefore this is haram, we cannot do this. He has guided this individual. وإنك لتهدي إلى صراط المستقيم, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. طيب, informing the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that he guides to the straight path. So that's the job of the anbiya, and it should be the job of every single, or the wadifa of every single Muslim, whereby he guides, he enjoins the good and forbids the evil. The second type of hidayah is the hidayah of tawfiq, which is the hidayah that is specific to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The hidayah that Allah guides the servant to the haqq. Allah says, إِنَّكَ لَا تَهْدِي مَنْ أَحْبَبْتَ. Allah says to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, verily you do not guide those who you love to be guided. طيب. Meaning that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that guides this individual, meaning it causes his heart to accept the guidance. And that's the guidance that we ask for in our salah every single day, every single rak'ah that we pray. إِهْدِنَا صِرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. And Allah guide us to the straight path. The guidance that is referred to in the surah of the Fatiha is the guidance of the tawfiq, asking for the tawfiq of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is specific and exclusive to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. None can guide in that form, in that manner, except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the fact that every single one of you is sitting here now, seeking knowledge, or practicing, or praying, and so on, that is a guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unto you. That is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestowed upon you, which shows that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants khayr and goodness for you. Look at how many millions of people there are in the world, or in your brother alone, in your area alone, in your family alone, who may not be Muslim, who may not be practicing, who may be on a shirk or al-bid'ah and so on. Lakin the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided you to al-Islam and to the sunnah, that is a ni'mah that is greater than all of the ni'ams and the blessings that anyone can attain. And Allah says, وَإِن تُعُدُّ نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا. Were you to try and count the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will not be able to count them. So it's worth saying Alhamdulillah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for guiding you, because it's not something that you achieved on your own. Think about how many people are committing fisq, how many people are involved in things that are in contradiction to the sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How many sisters are walking around, Muslim sisters are walking around without a hijab? How many people are walking around with يعني تبرج, with all of their parts showing? Muslims. لكن Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided you, clothed you, gave you the niqab, the hijab, and beautified you more than he has beautified these people who are showing their limbs. That's a virtue and a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and يعني the servant should never forget that that is a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. طيب, the sheikh says, أما بعد. Now we're going into the muqaddimah of the sheikh. The muqaddimah, the introduction of the kitab. And in general, it's very important to read the introduction clearly and carefully. Reason being, because in the muqaddimah, in the introduction, the author, not this specific book in general, lakin the author will clarify, will mention things that he shall read or that he shall say in his book. For example, Bulugh al-Maram, it's a kitab that many of you have heard of. Ibn Hajar rahimahullah, during the book, he uses terminologies like Rawahu al-Sitta, the sixth narrated it. Rawahu al-Sab'a, seven narrated it. Rawahu al-Shaykhan, for example. Rawahu al-Thalatha, illa. رواه الأربعة, four have narrated it, إلا النسائي or إلا ابن ماجه and so on. Now if someone just reads the book, opens it like that and reads it as it is, he's going to feel, what are these four people that he's referring to? These seven people, does he mean there's seven people from the Prophet to here to me, to this sanad? Or does he mean only seven companions were present at the time the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that hadith? The person will be confused. Lakin in the muqaddima, the introduction of the book, and it's a small introduction, he introduces it and he explains what it is that he means by 7, 6, 3, 4. For example, 7, he means Bukhari, Muslim, Ahmed, Abu Dawood, An-Nasa'i, At-Tirmidhi. 7, yani. The 4, Sunan, the Musnad of Imam Ahmed, and Bukhari and Muslim. 7. If he says 4, excluding Bukhari and Muslim, Abu Dawood, Tirmidhi, Ibn Majah, and An-Nasa'i. So it's important to read the introduction in general so that you understand what the Shaykh, or the reason why he says what he's going to say. The Shaykh says, فَهَذَا كِتَابٌ مُخْتَصَرٌ فِي الْفِقْهِ. This is a summarized book in the field or the science of al-fiqh. جَمَعْتُ فِيهِ بَيْنَ الْمَسَائِلِ وَالدَّلَائِلِ. I have combined in it the masail, or the Islamic jurisprudence, the different types of issues, yani salah being wajib, or wiping over the socks, wiping over the head, wiping over splintered plasters and so on, wudu, what limbs to wash and so on. I've combined between those issues with dala'il and their evidence. So in this book, the Shaykh is going to mention issues and he's also going to mention evidence for these issues. وَاقْتَصَرْتُ فِيهِ عَلَىٰ أَهَمِّ الْأُمُورِ. And I have sufficed with the most important topics alone. The things that are very important. The things that if a person doesn't do, his ibadah may not be accepted. So as you can see, the kitab is probably only one volume, or maybe even less. And the reason is because it's only to... the Shaykh only brings the things that are really important. وَأَعْظَمِهَا نَفْعًا. And the most beneficial of issues. So he only brings the most important ones and the beneficial ones. لِمَاذَا. Why is that? لِشِدَّةِ الضَّرُورَةِ إِلَى هَذَا الْمَوْضُعِ. Due to the dire necessity that people have for these issues that I shall mention. So we can see by his introduction that everything he's going to mention in this book is important. And it is a must that a person knows. Not just Kitab al-Salah, not just Kitab al-Tahara, how to make wudu, or how to pray, like in throughout, zakah, how to pray zakah, pay zakah, when one should pay zakah, fasting, who has to fast. If a person it doesn't fast due to illness, what should they do? Should they make up those days, or should they pay fidyah, and so on. These are very important issues, because every single one of us, tab'an, fasts, and every single one of us pays zakah, and every single one of us prays and performs wudu. طيب. وكثيراً ما أقتصر على النص إذا كان الحكم فيه واضحة. The Shaykh says, in a lot of the issues that you shall see, if the ruling is clear in the hadith or the verse, then I'll only mention the verse and the hadith. I won't explain it. Remember when I said to you a few weeks ago that whenever you're talking about an issue, you need to mention two things. When you're discussing an issue, any mas'ala, and you want to bring evidence, you need to bring two things. What are they? Ahsant. The dalil and the wajhu dalala. The dalil and wajhu dalala. For example, there was one of the questions, I think it was question number 16. Tayyib. When I said dalil and the wajhu dalala, the use of your evidence and how you want people to understand you, the way you've mentioned that hadith or the reason why. For example, the question is, if a person realizes they prayed with a thobe which is najis, do they have to repeat the prayer? Provide evidence. So obviously you would say no. And then you would say the hadith of what? The hadith of Jibreel, in which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was in his salah and Jibreel told him to remove his socks. طيب. After you mention the hadith, what's after that? Why and how you're using the hadith as evidence. And a lot of students did, Jazakumullah khair. So they would say that in this hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam took off his shoes, which were dirty, and he carried on with his salah. And at the end of the salah, he did not repeat what he'd prayed while he had the dirty socks, the dirty shoes on. Therefore, that proves that he did not repeat it. And because he did not repeat it, even though he had something dirty on, then likewise he doesn't have to, or this individual in question number 16 doesn't have to repeat the salah, because the Prophet ﷺ did not repeat the salah. So the evidence and the wajh al-dalala, how you're using the evidence. طيب. Also the Shaykh says, لِسُهُولَةِ حِفْظِهِ وَفَهْمِهِ لِسُهُولَةِ حِفْظِهِ. So the reason why he only mentions the most important issues is that it becomes easy to memorize for the student of knowledge. وَفَهْمِهِ عَلَى الْمُبْتَدِئِينَ. And so that they understand, or the ones that are new to fiqh can understand. لِأَنَّ الْعِلْمَ, because al-ilm is مَعْرِفَةُ الْحَقِّ, knowing the haqq, knowing the truth, بِدَلِيلِهِ, along with its dalil. Remember when we said مَعَ أَدِلَّتِهَا تَفْصِيلِيَّ, along with its evidence. So when you know the ruling of a certain thing, a certain issue, and you know the evidence as well, it shows that you're a faqih. It shows that you're a faqih. طيب, لأن العلم, نعم, والفقه, and fiqh is معرفة الأحكام الشرعية, is knowing that knowing the أحكام of the شرع, الفرعية, the action, the acts that we commit, that we do, not the اعتقاد, not the belief, بأدلتها, من الكتاب والسنة والإجماع والقياس الصحيح. طيب, the Shaykh mentions الكتاب, he mentions السنة, he mentions القياس and الإجماع. I'm going to briefly explain the latter two. Now the Quran is the kitab of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, starting from Surah Al-Fatiha up until Surah Al-Nas. So when the Quran is mentioned, the meaning is every single verse or every single harf that you find in the Mus'haf from Surah Al-Fatiha up until Surah Al-Nas. And the Quran is the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Is the Quran is the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is the kalam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And taba'an, it's the strongest type of evidence that a person can use. When you're discussing a specific issue, and you say, the ruling is this and this, the ruling is this and this, and the dalil is the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in surah kada wa kada wa kada. If you concentrate on Shaykh Fawzan, hafidhahullah, when he's replying to a question, he's answering a question, I mean, you'll always find that he uses, the Quran is at the tip of his tongue. He's always using evidence from the Quran. Next time you listen to Shaykh Fawzan on a question and answer, or even check out on YouTube, he's always got the Quran on his tongue. You'll find sometimes he'll be asked about 25 questions. And qadarullah, about 21 of those, he'll mention a verse, best, and he'll explain it. And the ruling is clear in that. So that's the Quran, ala kulli hal. Tayyib. The second thing is the sunnah that the Shaykh mentions. So in his book, he's going to bring evidence from the Quran and the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Tayyib, what is the sunnah? What is considered to be a sunnah? Huh?
Actions, statements,
and tukhrik, yeah.
And the thing that happened in his presence,
صح. He agreed to. كده, صح. As-Sunnah, when you're talking about the muhaddithin, when you're studying hadith, the meaning of sunnah is slightly different to when you're studying usul al-fiqh or fiqh. Slightly different, and we'll see. As-Sunnah, in our chapter now, fiqh, or usul al-fiqh, means ma nuqila عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. Anything that has been narrated from the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. من قول, from his speech, anything that he said. That's why a lot of these are hadith that we're going to come across. قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم كذا كذا وكذا. عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أنه قال كذا وكذا, that he said this and this. So it's the statement of Allah, a statement of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. أو فعل or anything that the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم done. An action of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. So for example, the companions would say, we saw the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم doing this and this and this. We saw the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم in Hajj al-Wada, in the Kaaba, drinking, standing up, so on. Something that the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم did. طيب. And obviously that is a hujjah, that is evidence, because the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, وما أتاكم رسوله فخذوه. Anything that the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم comes with, then take it. What was the first one? Statement. Anything that the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم said. Second one? Action. Anything that the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم did. So when we're talking about hujjah, or the stronger thing, then it is the qawl. The qawl, what the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم said, is stronger than what the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم did. In terms of hujjah. Reason being because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَى إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَى. He doesn't speak from, except from revelation, doesn't speak from desires and whims when he says something. However, the action, sometimes there's a reason why the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did a specific thing. عَلَى كُلِّ حَالٍ inshallah we'll study that in أصول الفقه. أو تقرير. تقرير means anything that was done in the presence of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam that he agreed with, or that he did not refute or rebuke. Anything that was done in the presence of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he is around and he's sitting, or at the time of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and it was done in another city, in Mecca, or even in Medina, but it was done on the outskirts and so on. Now that was done during the time of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That is also a hujjah. Why is it a hujjah? Because if it wasn't permissible, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would have informed them that it's not permissible. I think it was Khalid ibn Walid radiallahu anhu and Abdullah ibn Abbas that were eating a lizard, I believe it was put forward to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam on a table that he was eating, and he refused to eat it, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the companions asked him, is it haram? Yani? He goes, no, it's just not from the food of my people, it's not something I'm used to, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then Khalid and Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, they ate it. I believe it was a lizard or a bear, one of the two. They ate it. So that was done in his presence. So if it was haram, then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would have clarified it. So if someone can say, yeah, but the Prophet may not have known. Sah? If something was done on the outskirts of Medina, does the Prophet know the ilm al-ghayb? Does the Prophet know the unseen? La. But even then, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows, so if it wasn't permissible, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would have informed the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the Messenger would have informed them. Like it's happened in a lot of hadith. Tayyib, so that's the second type of hujjah. That's the second type of hujjah. When I said the muhaddithin and the usulin, have you realized we're not talking about, we haven't mentioned how the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam looked, or his attitude sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or his akhlaq. Fadl. Shama'il, na'am. That's the reason, that's what I'm talking about now. We haven't talked about how the Prophet looked ever, have we? And we haven't mentioned his akhlaq. وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَى خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. Like, we haven't mentioned it. Why? Because the usuliyun and the fuqaha, they can't derive a ruling from it. طيب, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was beautiful. Can we take a ruling from it? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had beautiful akhlaq. Can we take a ruling from it? La. Because we can't take a ruling from it, the scholars of Usul al-Fiqh and Fiqh, they do not mention it. Whereas if we're talking about the Muhaddithin, then it's going to be a different, we're going to add min sifati al-khalqiyya wa khalqiyya. from the attributes of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's why in Shama'il Muhammadiyya, the characteristics of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you'll find a lot of the hadith from the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. طيب. So that's the second thing that the Shaykh is going to mention as evidence in or throughout his book. The third thing is al-ijma', consensus of the scholars. Now the meaning is, or meaning of ijma' is ittifaqu jami' ulama' al-asr. It's the agreement of all of the scholars of a specific generation. An agreement from all of the scholars, or between all of the scholars of a specific generation. A specific generation. Be it the first, the second, the third, the fourth, whatever it may be. Generation. Ala amrin, upon a specific issue, min umuri al-deen, from the issues of the religion. So for example, the companions had ijma' on a certain issue. The companions, if they had an ijma' or consensus in a certain issue, then it's haram, impermissible for anyone to oppose that ijma'. So ijma' is a hujjah in itself. In any generation this could be. Even the generation of the tabi'een. If they had ijma' on a certain issue, then it's haram to oppose them after this ijma'. And this ijma' can happen at any given time, any generation. At any generation. Like once there's ijma', a consensus amongst the scholars on a certain issue, then it becomes hujjah. Becomes a type of proof. So you can say, for example, it's not permissible to combine Asr with Jum'ah. For example, if you're traveling and you just pray Jum'ah behind the Imam, khutbah and two rak'at, then you can't pray Asr. Someone can say the proof is the ijma' of the companions, or the ijma' of a certain number of scholars, the scholars of whichever generation it may be. So the ijma' is a hujjah itself, and the Shaykh uses it throughout his book. The fourth thing that the Shaykh, or the type of evidence that the Shaykh is going to use, is al-qiyas. Qiyas is analogy. Qiyas is analogy. Ilhaqu far'in bi asl. Connecting a sub-issue with the main issue. Fil hukm, in the ruling that you're deriving from it. So, you've got, for example, the asal, and you've got the far', or the branch, let's call it for now. And then you've got the ruling. And then you've got the reason. طيب. So that's the asl. And that is the branch, the far'. You want to connect these two. And why do you want to connect them? How do you want to connect them? Based on the ruling. Why? Due to the reason, or the illah, that is, that they share. I'll give you an example. As we're going to see in the chapter of containers and utensils, we're going to see that it's haram, impermissible, to drink, eat or drink from gold utensils, gold plates, gold plates. Dhahab wal fidda, dhahab. It's haram to eat from. You can't have gold spoons and gold forks and gold plates and cups. It's haram. Due to the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, لا تأكل في عينة ذهب والفضة. Don't eat from the utensils of the golden فضة, silver. طيب, that's the ruling. So the ruling is what? That it is, I'll leave the ruling out, gold. That is haram to eat from gold plates. طيب. What did I say the ruling was? Come talk back to me, talk back to me. Haram. What's the reason? Due to the hadith, like, what are some of the reasons that it may be haram? Imitating kuffar, for example. The scholars, they mentioned several different reasons or illas. From them is imitating the kuffar. طيب. From these is that it's very expensive and it's not fair on the poor people. Because if a poor person who barely has any cutlery or any cups or any spoons and forks in his house sees another Muslim with gold forks, that is going to harm him emotionally, sah? So they say, the scholars say, preserving the feelings of the poor person. So you can either use preserving the feelings of a poor person as a reason why it's haram, or tashabbuh bil kuffar, that it's not permissible to act according to how the kuffar act. طيب. That's the reason, right? So what have we got now? The asal, the origin is gold plates, it's haram to use, right? طيب. And the ruling of gold plates is haram. What's the reason? Imitating the kuffar or not spoiling the feelings of or harming the feelings of the poor person, sah? طيب. The branch or the fara that we want to connect with the asal here is diamond plates, diamond cups, diamond spoons. Have they been mentioned in the hadith? Only dhahab and fidda have been mentioned, sah? Diamond hasn't been mentioned. طيب, what's the ruling of diamond? When you look at the illas or the reason, you can say, common sense will tell you that diamond is sometimes worth more than gold. It can be more expensive than gold. That's why for a wedding ring, people prefer diamond and don't prefer gold. Sah? So they say the reason, because the reason is also present in diamond, then we put diamond here, and it also has the same ruling as the gold. طيب. The hadith, does it talk about diamond? No, it doesn't talk about diamond. What does it talk about? Gold and silver. Lakin the scholars say, because of the reason or the illah, the same illah is present here that is present in the gold. So that's qiyas ala kulli hal. You find it a lot. And it's a type of evidence. Obviously the Quran is the strongest, then the sunnah, then the ijma', then al-qiyas. طيب. So the Sheikh mentioned these four. Al-ijma' wal-qiyas wal-sahih. طيب. And the Sheikh says, carries on with his introduction, says, وَأَقْتَصِرُ عَلَى الْأَدِلَّةِ الْمَشْهُورَةِ خوفا من التطويل. And I will, مشهورة. I will only mention the evidences that are يعني well known amongst the people. Because you may find a certain issue, مسألة, and there's hundreds of ahadith for it. But the Sheikh says, I won't mention them for fear of the book being long. I'll only mention the most important or the hadiths that are the most common hadiths that we hear now. For example, إِنَّمَا الْعَمَالُ بِالنِّيَاتِ. We hear that all the time, sah? That's a hadith that can be used in every single chapter in fiqh. So the Sheikh will only mention the hadith because it's wadih, it's clear, and it's the most common one that is narrated in that chapter. And the Sheikh says, وَإِذَا كَانَتِ الْمَسْأَلَةُ خِلَافِيَّةِ. And if the issue is a mas'ala of khilaf, and there's khilaf in the specific issue that I will mention, اقتصرت على القول, then I will only mention this, the opinion الذي ترجح عندي, that I deem, that I feel is the strongest opinion. And so you'll find that in this book the Sheikh only mentions one opinion. He won't say وفيه خلاف. Whereas in the other books of fiqh you'll find there's a lot of khilaf in it. Mughni, for example, Ibn Qudama, Mughni, Al-Mughni, he mentions the khilaf of all of the four madhahib and the evidence that they use and how they refute the other madhab and so on. So it's mutawwal, it's a very long book, about 14 or 15 volumes, each volume being about that big. So it's very long. Like in the Sheikh says, I will only mention the statement that is strongest in my opinion. طيب. تبعاً للأدلة الشرعية. While I'm following the adilla of the shari'. The Sheikh now goes into al-ahkam al-khamsa. The five rules. Should we leave the rest for question and answers and then? طيب. We'll stop here, inshallah. We'll stop on al-ahkam al-khamsa. We'll start from there next week, inshallah. The five rulings, meaning wajib, sunnah, mustahab, makruh, muharram. What are these? Hopefully, inshallah, we're going to study them next week, and then we're going to start on the book. Well, we've started on the book, like, and hopefully, we're going to finish the introduction next week. Like, if there are any questions, then you can put them forward, or you can ask them, the brothers, or we can just call it a day. Yeah. It's 19, it's okay. Dave.
Well, we're going to pray the Maghrib here. If you're able to move, toilets in that way, but you have to go outside, inshallah, come to that sort of thing.
And it would be the brothers, tell them to write their names if they haven't, anyone that's, everyone that's attended. One of the brothers that have, anyone that's come from the beginning to now. Obviously, more than three lessons, obviously. Oh, Zaki, salam alaikum. You alright? How's it going? You alright, yeah? Alhamdulillah. Any questions from the Bob side? MashaAllah. Thanks.
Sisters, as usual, you can write down your questions, inshallah.
Shemail. Huh? Bid. The dying of the beard, yeah? With anything to do with the beard, there's so many hadith that the Messenger said, "Wa'fu liha," keep your beards. So that will come under. That will come under qawl. Huh? The dying, there's a hadith in which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prohibited from dying the hadith, the beard.
So most scholars say it's allowed. They will say that based on some of the Sahaba describing the beard, dying Shama'il.
Yeah, even though it's in Shama'il, not anything that is meant to, not anything that is found in Shama'il, is not considered to be from the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Like, if, for example, the Prophet commanded, I believe in the hadith, to not to dye the beard, but not to dye it black. Now that's a statement. So that will come under the qawl. So there'll be with it any khilaf, like all of the other masail, any khilaf that can take place in all of the other masail, then likewise it takes place in that masala as well. But it's, that's not only a masala that is mentioned to be qawl from the shama'il. Even though it's shama'il, but it's still from the qawl of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then the fi'l. La, because from the Shama'il is Qawl. From the Shama'il is Qawl. If you're talking about just specifically how he looked, just how he looked, nah, that's not a Qawl.
Right,
but they don't listen, no one's listening.
They're
asked, tell them to be quiet.
Salaam alaikum. We are actually on Q&A. Tafaddalu, ask your questions, inshallah.
Can I go first?
Yeah, no. I've got 1 second, just dealing with one of the Shama'il. If we're talking about how the Prophet ﷺ looked, how tall he was, this, you can't derive a ruling from it. Like in the ruling, the thing to do with the dyeing of the beard and the beard keeping it long and so on, and how the Prophet kept his beard, that comes under the qawl of the Prophet ﷺ, because he said, leave your beards, wa'fu liha. Right? Like, go on. The Quran and the Sunnah. The Quran, the Kalam of Allah, the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from Surah Al-Fatiha up until Surah Al-Nas. Huh? The question is, what are the two types of hujjahs? The first two hujjahs that you mentioned, the hujjahs that the Shaykh mentioned is the Quran and the Sunnah, and they are proof in of itself. For example, you say the Quran is the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when you're talking about an issue, you say this is haram due to the verse of Allah. Or the second one being the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Anything that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, did, or that was done in his presence that he agreed with.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. In أخطر المختصرات of it mentions that small amount of silver is allowed if it's necessary. Does this come under qiyas?
No, it doesn't come under qiyas. There's a specific hadith for hadith Anas radiallahu anhu that we're going to see in the chapter of utensils. There's a specific hadith in which the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam had a cup or had a utensil, and there was a small portion of it that was broken, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used silver to bring it together. Like, we shall see that in the chapter. I only mentioned this as a sub issue. Like, it has to be silver, and it has to be small, and it has to be due to a need. But it's permissible with those three conditions. That time, if they're not